fuck up. It's time to talk business. Jared Taylor, Matt Best, and Evan Hafer proudly present Blackhearted. Sponsored by Black Rifle Coffee Company and Arson Wave.
Well,
hello. Wakes you right up.
Yeah,
it wakes you right up.
That's the intro I've been after Zach to try and.
I saw that look at him backstage, and you're like, "Hey, that's what I was talking about."
That's what I was talking about.
I can put you in touch with the guys that did that.
That would be awesome,
dude. Yeah, because they happily make you one.
Yeah, that'd be bomber.
I mean, they got that done in 2 days.
Really?
Yeah.
That'd be great.
I gave them loose description of what we wanted, and they went for it.
Oh, love it, love it. Zach, are you taking notes?
So welcome back to Blackhearted, man. We literally just transitioned straight over from our live feed, and we're recording for iTunes right now, available for download.
Yeah. So if you're watching, you get an early treat.
Ooh.
Nice. Look at it's Jeff. Like the day before Halloween,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah. What happens there?
We'll get into that later.
You bought for apples in the bedroom?
Yeah.
But before we crossed over, you guys were talking about how you and Jeff met, and I actually never heard this story from back then. So
oh,
I'm
really?
Curious. No, I've never heard the story. Not the OG story. So.
Oh, wow.
Oh.
Yeah, so Jeff Kirkham is, he's going to join us from Ready Man, and Jeff's got a long resume. It's 20 some years long, I suppose. So I'll kind of sum it up into the fact that behind Wally, he's the baddest fucking dude that we know in the building. So I'm gonna second fiddle to Wally.
After the story of Jeff, then Jeff has to explain who Wally is.
Yeah, we'll explain who Wally is. I mean, and we really need to talk about Black Rifle Coffee, but you know, Jeff, 28 year Green Beret, right?
Yeah.
Fuck, 28 years. Then he went on. He was an undercover narcotics officer. Before that, he was he worked in the prisons as a prison guard. He fought a little bit in back in the day, the amateur fighting. Yeah. And then he was a contractor for quite a few years working overseas. And so he is by far one of the most proficient combat artisans I know, as far as like the people that I can count on one hand that I would rely on their information.
I feel like that's a shirt, proficient life taker,
or just combat artisan.
I like combat artisan.
I really like combat artisan.
Yeah, that's good.
Like that a lot. I'll have that done by today.
So you know, Jeff Kirkham, obviously he's over at Ready Man. He's got the rapid application tourniquet system. He and I started a company called Twist Raid together a few years ago, which dirt napped.
But that's how we met, so I'm happy for it.
Yeah, how we all met. He's one of my best friends. He's one of the guys that I can rely on the information that comes out of his mouth, more so than most men, because he'll shoot you straight, and most of the time he knows what the fuck he's talking about. If not, he actually makes up some pretty goddamn good lies. They fucking sound good.
Great bullshit artist.
At least he can talk you into it.
So Jeff and I met 17 years ago. In the City of Rocks in Idaho. On a climbing trip,
yeah. So believe it or not, I was trying to climb rocks. Not very well, though.
No, you were pretty good. Like, Tom Bigley, I mean, he was a fat fuck, too. And he, like, could scrape his fat ass up that wall.
Fat fuck, too.
And, not two. I should say he was a fat fuck. Like,
Jeff was not
even close to being fat or being labeled as that. Two was a misrepresentation. Tom Bigley was a fat fuck then. He had that fucking boiler. You remember that thing? That fucking big old beer gut boiler, and he didn't drink. I didn't know where it came from, but that's a different story. Tom, he's a great dude. We met in City Rocks, so I came into the hotel with, I think I'd driven down that night in the Suburban with a couple other guys, and we walked into the hotel, and there's this dude that looked like Wayne Grove from Heat. So he had like long scraggly hair and a bunch of earrings and like a fucking rock band shirt and like holes. Like literally the dude looked like he just crawled out of a dumpster, like a dangerous dumpster.
Iron Maiden shirt, actually.
Yeah.
Oh, that's fucking solid. Cool though.
And he's Wayne Grove. Sitting at the table, and I turned to the guy next to me. No, I turned to the guy next to me. I'm like, are we fucking buying a homeless dude a sandwich? Or what the fuck is going on here? Like, why is this motherfucker sitting with us? They're like, that's Jeff. Don't ask about him. Just look away. Don't look him in the eyes. Just look away. And I was like, whoa, okay. He was the dude that would jump and he would wear a balaclava. He would just wear the balaclava and a fucking...
Well, because I was on relaxed grooming standards because we had a squared away company commander. And so because I was working all this undercover stuff and I had long hair and a long beard, then I was like, hey, I need to be on relaxed grooming standards. So Greg was like, yeah, no problem. So, but rather than try to explain to the pilots when we were jumping, it was just easier to just throw a balaclava on and then... They're like, oh, one of these kids is not like the other. But it was less of a question than some dude with long hair, you know, jumping out of their plane. And it's like, are we doing civilian skydiving now or something? So,
yeah, wear a flight suit and a balaclava.
You know, that's always like surprised me.
Fucking crazy
like,
shit.
It surprised me in the military that you don't just, like, just shut up. Like, you're a pilot of a jet of the plane. Like, you don't need to be concerned with what the grooming standards are of the guys jumping out of your plane. Yeah. Like, why? If you have to ask, don't you think like it's supposed
nobody
to
else
be
has
like
noticed?
That? Yeah, yeah. Oh man, you were the first one to figure out does that I command, had this giant beard.
Does your commander know
yeah,
that you have
right
hair
there.
In the middle
Go
of your back?
Go tell him.
Yes. Just don't worry about it. What were you doing back then?
I was a SF guy.
Oh, you were in at that
I was
time.
A, dirty young E6.
We are Green Beret heavy at the Black Rifle office.
Yeah, we got a bunch of SF guys here. I mean, a lot of first group guys.
We need a resident seal.
Guys, yeah.
We need a resident seal. You got two tech P's,
but
too.
You know what that would do to the entire numbers? It would throw them off, and dudes would be like more concerned with the way they look than actually getting work done. And
like, well, technically,
hey,
we do.
Well, I'm paying you. You know, like I would have to have these conversations where I'm like, dude, we're paying you to work for Black Rifle. And it's like, but I'm working on my book, bro. It's going to be super good.
Sounds like me right now. Shit.
Oh, fuck. That was not meant as that. So, you know, Jeff and I actually weren't, we weren't friends. We weren't friends until we went to Kuwait, I think.
Yeah.
And we started spending more time together. Actually, we started like inventing stuff together. I was like your little fucking helper. You know, we were like doing low vis fucking vests and we were working on a bunch of fucking weird stuff.
Yeah, I remember
stuff.
That now. Yeah.
And you were working on that Picatinny rail for the M2.
Yep.
I was working on the low vis stuff.
Yep.
Like taking it to the sew shop, and guys thought I was dumb as shit, by the way. I would just like to like say this, that they thought this
it's
was
young.
Crazy, and they were
it's
like,
young.
This is crazy. You need like 15 mags, and you need to have like, you know, wrap around fucking soft armor, and like all this crazy. I'm like, dude, I mean, can't we just wear like a plate hanger? Like this shit looks really good. And plus it's like, you know, it's like a level 12 plate. It weighed like 17 pounds.
Yeah, because back then in 02, when we were getting ready for the invasion, then like plate hangers didn't really, like the guys that are at home, like all of the modern stuff that you see like army guys wearing now didn't exist.
Nope.
So no, there was no, the it was
armored
a,
vehicles
the first,
didn't exist.
Well, first off, the first... All you had in 2003 that made gear was Blackhawk. And then your first modular system before anything was Light Fighter, which was then bought by Tactical Taylor. So Light Fighter appeared at Fort Bragg in 2004. That was the first time you could go in and buy a single pouch. Yeah. Like, oh, wow.
Well, that all changed
this
after the invasion because people were like, I don't want to run around the streets of Iraq with, you know, 70 pounds of armor on me. I'll just take freaking 6 or 8 mags and call it a day.
We evolved quite a bit. I mean, we had a discussion for... We were trying to figure out what to do with our gun jeep. So, like, mobility with vehicles and stuff is brand new for the military, too. Well, not brand new anymore, but at the time, like, the only guys who had trucks were mech infantry and 5th Special Forces Group.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, we show up, we fall in on our Humvees, and they're like, okay, these things were supposed to go through DRMO, like, 2 years ago, but now they're yours. You're going to drive these into Baghdad, and... Here's all your guns that you can figure out how to put on here. And it was like the biggest discussion that we had for like protection. Remember this was whether to keep the windshield or not.
Yeah.
So it was like, do you keep the windshield? Do you not keep the windshield? Then a 5th group guy got a rock in the face and knocked out a bunch of his teeth. And it was like, oh, we'll keep the
windshield. We'll keep the windshield.
But there was no doors. We didn't even have doors on those things.
No, we took the doors off. We made like these super weird bungee contraptions for...
Like the cruisers.
I had these SIG fully auto fucking shorties that we had stolen off of fucking Target. We had rightfully owned off of Target.
Battlefield
acquisition.
And like shorty AKs with 100 round fucking drums with bungee systems. And it was like the most Mad Max looking stupid shit that you could do.
That's fun though.
And it was so funny because like we had been there for several months. So when we get to Baghdad, I walked by one of my really good friends at a weapons cache. Like it was like an SF shopping spree at this place in Baghdad. Like, it was fucking rad. And I walked like right by him and we looked like absolute hammered dog shit because the other guys from Fifth Group literally had fucking flown in and they were invading the country like 30 days later. Their uniforms weren't even like dirty basically.
Right.
And we were like, well, we'd been there for 6 months. We like none of my uniforms were even like serviceable at that point. I had a big fucking gaping hole down the groin of my pants, so my balls hung out, and I didn't sew it. So I would paint a new smiley face on my nuts every day, and then Bear would go, what kind of a day is it? My team leader would be like, well, it's a fucking happy day, man. Look at this.
and then Rob Pruss, when he, that's a great story, by the way, when he swapped the engine out.
Yeah, yeah. I was telling these guys a story about that.
Dude, yeah, because we got picked up by a Humvee that started overheating in Tampa. And Evan was like, I've been down this road before.
Yeah, it was literally.
First time I'd ever heard it.
Yeah, so you know that like swapping out an engine in the middle of the desert is Rob and I.
Yeah, with a Leatherman.
Seriously, Jesus. Yeah. Two days of just like turning wrenches and beating your knuckles against the fucking edges of everything and not knowing a damn thing about Humvees. You tend to learn a lot, but nonetheless, I you know we digress down the rabbit hole of you know innovation, right? So trying to evolve or innovate, what is it like? Innovation is the mother of necessity or something.
Necessity is the mother of innovation.
Yeah, there we go.
Yep.
Yeah, I need something and I don't have it, so what do I
here's have? A question I have for you guys. Did you get when you guys were at that weapons cache and stuff, I always wondered why didn't we use RPGs?
Because you couldn't trust them, like really? Straight up, man.
They're
like,
just
like
inconsistent.
We had mortar tubes and RPGs and all kinds of shit. Honestly, we couldn't trust them.
So like one of Jeff's rules that I go by.
One of Jeff's live by these rules
so that you can live and have all your fingers and toes is if it explodes, if I don't know where it came from, I didn't mess with it. We just destroyed it. Because RPGs are a phenomenal weapon. They're actually the fact that we don't use them in the U.S. I think is kind
this
of
this is my is, question. Is like, dumb. Why didn't we redesign that? I mean, I know we have the Carl Gustav that is a reloadable.
Amen.
You know,
but it's a recoilless.
Yeah, but why?
But the RPG is phenomenal. Like the RPG is the most.
Why
underrated.
Did we go to the AT4 where it's a
because
one-time?
We're dumb. Yeah. Because we're dumb. I mean, it's the only thing I would say is because we're dumb. Because some engineer that's never been on the battlefield was like, "Yo, this
one-time use.
This
just
will work
rip
great.
It out of the package and
so
boom."
Stupid.
Like, and then you take. And that goes into kind of like talking about the AK and stuff. And so, but if you take the RPG, so the mother of the RPG was the Panzerfaust that was designed by the Germans. So you figure the Germans at that point had been it. So you're talking a weapon system that was designed by people who had been in battle. And they're like, hey,
for a long
this.
Time.
For a long time. And then you take the RPG, and the RPG, they took the Panzerfaust, and they're like, hey, that was a great idea. How do we make this better? And it was developed. If you see the numbers of Russians that were killed in World War II, like, every single Russian was affected by World War II. Every single Russian knew multiple people that were killed and probably was in combat
themselves. It was
22
plus million, correct?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, lost. Tens of millions of Russians were killed.
You lost 70% of the military age males in Russia.
70%?
Yeah.
Holy shit.
So now all of a sudden, when you start talking about a weapon system that was developed, it's like the dudes who got that and refined it, developed it, whatever, absolutely were like, this thing's got to work in multiple hemispheres, it's got to work in multiple climates and temperatures, and it's got to be easy and blah 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 blah. And that's why, like, why we don't use RPGs, like an updated RPG, so thin steel tube with carbon fiber on the outside with multiple changing warheads and stuff like that is dumb in my opinion, because the RPG is like our guys
I
in
can
Afghanistan.
Think of so many situations where to accurate. See one of our guys run up with a backpack full of cool RPGs, be like, yeah, he's here.
I think the main thing is just having the ability to change the
change
head,
warheads. Yeah.
Because it's like you get in a tick and you're like, wow, I have a fucking thermal barrack, you know, law. Like, what am I going to do with this thing against a freaking...
You got an airburst freaking RPG. Yeah. Woo!
Let's party.
So what you're saying is it would have been a good time to date in the 1960s
No,
in Russia.
Dude, I've told this to multiple people. Where would you go in a time machine? First, I would go straight back to being in the agency. I think in 1956 would have been probably from there to 1970.
Yeah, it would have been bomber.
Would have been like nobody had any controls. It was carte blanche. Suitcases of Marshall Plan. Suitcases of Plan.
Suitcases of Plan. Yeah. Suitcases of Plan.
Suitcases of Marshall Plan. Like, I fucking love the fact that... Like,
well, and they were all World War II vets, and so... Nobody could really tell them what to do, and they had already laid in a bunch of their stuff during the war. And
talk about a great time. And if you could have been, like, you know, cruising around in that era with suitcases full of cash, I'm fairly certain you would have been able to just bang your way all through fucking Europe and anywhere and everywhere you wanted to put
it. Super good film concept. You just call like combat time machine, and you just travel back to periods of time, but with all modern equipment.
I want that so bad. I really want a movie where a fucking Abrams goes back to Gettysburg.
They have it. There was, like, some guy sent me the link to some B movie, and the dude, like, brought like an ODA comes out of the fucking woods in Virginia. Yeah,
it's like what movie lightning. Is this?
I forget. Somebody will know. So post it. But yeah, it's like an SF ODA training in North Carolina, and then like a lightning storm happens, and then it's like, what? We got all these guns. Holy shit! We're gonna mow these dudes down. You know, I'm fairly certain most guys in the ODA would have not fought for the North, but that's just my. Just my own perception.
States' rights.
Like, States' rights. I'm just saying. I'm like, you go to fifth group. I'm fairly certain there's not a lot of North fighters up there. You know. So you know, I want to get back to the fact that you know, Jeff Kirkham, longtime friend, a longtime business partner. We share the offices here at Black Rifle Coffee. So we share the offices with a bunch of different guys, mainly guys that we've known for a long period of time. Or guys we trust. You know, Burt Kuntz from Peacemaker is a good example. Former first group guy, 18 Delta, warrant officer. Jeff Kirkham right down the hall, Ready Man, inventor, content provider, and then business owner. So he's got a lot of information that he can put out. He puts out a ton of information every week. Actually, you do two episodes a week, right?
Three, actually, if you count the Funker. So we do a Monday live where it's more talking heads. Mm-hmm. We do a Thursday live where it's more of a tutorial that's an hour long. And then on Wednesday, I help with Funker 530, where we go through and dissect combat footage, because sometimes it's not always absolutely evident of what's going on. And some of the combat footage is from older times. And so I saw the war from the beginning all the way to essentially the end. And so tactics and techniques that we're using in the early days are not the same stuff that we do now. So it helps to, keep the trolls or keep the good idea fairies down when guys are like, well, why didn't they just do that? And it's like, well, because at that time frame in the war, that tactic was not being used because of blah, blah, blah. There was no resources or there's no training or whatever that is.
Right.
So,
right. Well, and what we're really talking about in the sense of the mother of invention is necessity, right?
Necessity.
So, you know, Jeff has been inventing and doing a lot of different things, and specifically, I guess, in the combat community or world for over a decade now. So he's got 7 patents. Is that what you said?
Yeah, 7 or 8, 9.
7 or 9, some odd number.
We should go back and check.
And you know, how many months of your life do you think, or years of your life, have you spent in a combat zone?
Spent a little over 8 years in boots on the ground in between Afghanistan and Iraq, and that's not counting the time that was when first group, like Haiti, right, and stuff like that. But so just over 8 years total with boots on the ground. So it spanned at about 13 total years. From about 02, or, you know, if we count 02,
03,
02, yeah, 03, all the way up to 2013,
right,
or so, is about the last time that I went over.
That's so a lot.
We should add the combat time of all the executive staff in this building. That should be a number we have.
Yeah, it'd be interesting. Just to take a look. You know, the other thing that we did was we just hired Wally. So tell Wally's story.
So we just hired on Wally. So he was actually an Afghan commando that I happened to work with over in Afghanistan. He's a phenomenal individual. And he started when he was 18. He's now in his 30s.
Right.
And he was on the rotation of so if you want to talk about combat experience, he was on the rotation of, you know, they were on for a month and for a training cycle, then they'd be on for a month for mission cycle, then they'd go home for 2 weeks, and then come back and start training cycle, mission cycle, then leave cycle was 2 weeks. And then a lot of times too, depending on the operations tempo, they would take the guys that were in the training and go, hey, guess what?
Yeah, fill a slot in the operational
on mission
side.
Cycle.
Yeah.
And so, because there'd be multiple stuff that was going on. So he did that for 13 years. So,
right.
You know, and all of it, you know.
It was 13 years, yeah.
It was 13 years.
How many targets do you think
just
been on?
Battle?
I mean, it's got to be a couple of thousand.
Right.
You know, you figure during a decent operations tempo, you know, you're talking about a target or so a night, depending on if there were follow-on targets or something like that. So you figure if you're on mission cycle for a month, and then he also was part of a group that stayed more busy than others typically. And so
I like the ambiguity.
You like that?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So, you know, probably thousands. I mean,
right.
he's done, and all of that was shoulder to shoulder with U.S. Special Forces.
And you've watched
and
him fight.
Stuff.
And he's a...
Yeah.
He's
yeah, actually, when he found me, because I was doing a Funker 530, and one of the guys came on and was like, hey, there's some guy says he knows you. And I was like, oh, well, the last I'd heard, Wally had been killed in an ambush. So, like, the Taliban were literally calling him up on the phone and going, hey, we're going to kill you, and we're going to kill your family, and it's only a matter of time. Because
holy
you can
shit.
Only hide it for so
yeah.
long. So they'd call him, and this was going on for a couple of years, where they call him as like, yeah, we didn't get you last time, but we'll get you this time. So the last ambush that he went through, because they'd try and ambush him when he was going home or coming away. So
that's how a lot of the commanders get killed. And we had a guy get killed, was they would just leave to go home and leave on their bike or their car.
Yep.
And they'd Taliban would have an ambush set up to just execute him.
Yep.
And then find out where he lives, drive home and kill their families.
Yep. Yep. That's exactly. So the last time, his last ambush, his car was hit 11 or 15 times. And, he was like, yeah, somehow they didn't get me. Well, I had heard that he had been killed. And so then when I heard, when I saw that it was him, I was like, holy cow. And he had immigrated on a special visa status, had immigrated to the U.S. because at that point his whole family, extended family, was like, hey, dude, you're too hot. You need to get out of here because you're putting the rest of the family in at
danger.
So he essentially packed up his family. He's got five sons and his wife. And whatever they could carry, they flew over to the U.S. So, mind you, it took him 2 years to get his visa. And then finally got his visa, came to the U.S., was here, landed, was in a, you know, crap housing while he was here, and went from being a combat commander to working in a cashier at a gas station. And then we found him, and it was like, holy cow. So Evan and I spoke, and it was like, get that dude on a plane. So we flew him out here. Walked around the building, and he's like, and for you guys that don't know, the Salt Lake Valley is almost identical in climate and scenery as Kabul, you know, minus the trees. Get rid of the trees.
And then all the burning shit. I mean, we have the inversion, so maybe a little bit.
We have the inversion, but the same inversion exists in Kabul, but they burn tires for factories and stuff.
And so,
anyways, we brought him out here, and he's like, wow, this is awesome. We're like, go home. Pack up your family. So brought him out here, and he's working out here with us now too,
which is crazy to think, because I think a lot of times the U.S. government and people forget about the amount of sacrifice that like local nationals mm-hmm. did to serve our country and their own country.
Yeah.
And then it's just kind of leave them in the dust, because
he's actually had 15 members of his immediate family have been killed during the last couple of decades of war over there.
That's
a lot,
fucking crazy.
Big chunk of them, and supporting the U.S. because his entire family is pro U.S. and has been working with the U.S. military and stuff. So,
and he's like the sweetest, nicest, humble man when you talk
Dude,
to him.
Could you
and hardworking. He probably outworks 98% of the American staff at BlackRifle.
Yeah, he's great.
Can you
guy.
Imagine some punk coming in to rob him in that gas station.
Because you know, he looks like just a regular dude. Just like,
and that poor kid that just that doesn't suspect anything.
Yeah.
His eyes just squint and he's like, yes.
So, the old days. So what I'd like to get on is basically, you know, you started inventing. You've been an inventor as long as I know, have known you. I mean, the M2 Picatinny rail mount, I mean, that was literally out of necessity because we didn't have, there wasn't even a fucking option to mount anything for the feed tray cover.
Tracers.
Or anything. Yeah. Tracers. Follow it. Tracers. Like, you felt like you were in 1946. What the fuck is this?
That's just how Jeff's brain functions from knowing you for a couple of years now. Just like you're a serial innovator, where if you look at something, where I look at it and I go, man, the functionality of this is awesome. You look at that same thing, go, yeah, the functionality is awesome, but how do I make it better and how can I make it more applicable for the task at hand that I'm going to do? And like, it's been a fun thing to watch with the tourniquets and even that, the bag you guys just released. I was like, Jesus, I've been looking for a bag like this for so long to pull an SBR or, you know, a nice whatever pistol out of there, and it's phenomenal.
Even the early days, didn't you guys design an image that is widely used by SF now?
Yeah, we did. We were in the Philippines and we were deployed to what was the island? Is it Mindanao?
No, it was on the main island. We were actually up north in I just lost it. Well, we were up in communist held territory.
Yeah.
And
we got shot at up there. I got shot at up there. I was taking a shit. And I was like, what is that? What is that? Yeah. What are those? Little bees? What are those?
Stinging
bees. And
the
guy's like, sir, you're being shot at. I'm like, really? And Steve Strand stands up. I'm like, don't stand up, you dumb motherfucker.
And Steve's like 6'3".
Yeah. Anyway, so we had this, the tomahawk, the knife,
well, it was,
and the arrow.
It was from the new Defiant, so the door kicker teams. So, like, everybody's a door kicker now, but that time in SF, like, if you were going to do close quarter battle or something, you had to go to the special school, and then if you were going to do discriminatory fire, good guy, bad guy targets, then you had to go to this other special school, and then there was this other really special school that was called Sephardic that you'd go to, and only Sephardic guys. So anyways, the new Defiant is a skull with two arrows and a dagger going through it. And so anyways, we were, all of the guys on our team, most of us were cops, you know, I was in DEA and stuff, and we were already kicking doors and going in warrants. And so when we came back, Evan and I were sitting in the Philippines. Mind you, the Philippines, like, the room was not much bigger than this one. Actually, it was about this size, and it was the only room on that entire base that had air conditioning, like, part of the time. And it was, like, unbelievably hot. We're in the jungle. It was unbelievably hot. You walk out, within 5 minutes, your shoes were going because of all the sweat. So anyways, we're sitting in there and we're designing that was like, hey, let's take this. I was really into tomahawks at the time. I'd read a couple of books by Alan W. Eckert about the frontiersman, and I'd helped a company, American Tomahawk Company, that doesn't exist anymore, help them with a synthetic handle and a tomahawk, because that, you know, first thing you do when you pick up a tomahawk is you want to throw it, right? And so the handles will break. And so I was like, hey, why don't we use this other type of material I'd found with another project. So anyways, I was into tomahawks, and we started going to town on this thing. I didn't know anything about computers, and so Evan did a little bit. And I think we built that first one on Word. But what's interesting now is...
No,
so
it's the Paint.
Yeah,
paint.
Microsoft Paint.
Oh, and Paint.
Yeah. I started there too, pixel by pixel.
Yes, yep.
Erasing each pixel.
Yep. So we changed the dagger into a Bowie knife.
Yep.
And then we removed one of the arrows and put a tomahawk on there. And so that's kind of where this came from. And actually, like, it looks like this, sort of.
Yeah.
Yeah,
the right, but it's the same thing as the
skull instead of,
and we have the same logo on the calf, or caffeinated as fuck logo.
And what's interesting, man, I've seen, like, Marines have used that, and some SEALs, and which is cool. I have at it. I mean, that's, you know, we threw it out there.
Yeah, you guys painted on your gun trucks too.
Yeah, we had it on the Invasion that was on our gun trucks.
I painted question marks. Why? Because I was like, I don't know what the fuck's going to happen.
My life's a question. Whether or not I'm going to die.
Thank you for listening to Blackhearted. Tune in next week as we conclude our conversation with Jeff Kirkham.
Black Rifle Coffee Company, along with Arson Wave, would like to thank you for tuning in to Blackhearted. Have a great fucking day.